I knew that I wanted to be a writer around 14 years old. I thought that I wanted to first be a doctor like my father. And then when I was in high school, I was bullied a lot. And I was not a person who liked to retaliate or be confrontational. And so I suppressed a lot of my emotions and my feelings. And writing was that therapeutic vent through which I can find solace. And so when I went on to college and I studied comparative literature, I knew that I wanted to go to New York City. I was from a small town in South Jersey, and my dream, like many other people, was to come to the Big Apple and to get discovered and to become a literary star. And when I was an upperclassman in college, they told me a couple of things. One of the things they told me was that I had to do an unpaid internship, which, as you know, it takes a bit of socioeconomic privilege to be able to do something like that. But I did it. I did the unpaid internship. I was spending all day going back and forth from Central Jersey to Manhattan for 15-minute interviews so that I can be considered for editorial assistant positions at various publications and publishers. And I didn't get a job. I didn't get a single job. And I thought that I did everything right. I went to an Ivy League university. I studied literature. I was multilingual. I did the unpaid internships, but I did not get a single job. And it was very depressing. On top of that, on a personal end, I pretty much got dumped by a guy that I thought was like the love of my life at the time. And so I just felt like I was being hit from all angles, professionally and personally. And so I moved back home with my mother, and my mother was ecstatic about it because we're very close. And I was in bed a lot. I was in bed on the internet an embarrassingly long amount of hours a day. And I was doing little things on the side. I was ballroom dancing to help stave off depression. And I was tutoring at my friend's parents' company no more than 5 to 6 hours a week. And in the summer of 2014, Michael Brown died. And Michael Brown's death in Ferguson, Missouri was the start of the Black Lives Matter movement. And at that time in 2014, there was this hunger for Black voices. At the same time, there was this hunger for young women to write about the most dark or the deepest parts of their lives for bylines or for money. And that's how many women, and especially women of color like myself, got our start. We didn't get our starts doing breaking news or investigative reporting. We didn't have the money or the bandwidth or the support to do that. We built up our portfolios by writing personal essays or hot takes. And so hot takes are short pieces where you immediately respond to the news. And I always knew, even at 22 years old, I knew that I wasn't the best writer, but I knew I was going to work harder than the best writer. And so it was a type of thing where if I needed to write 1,000 words in 45 minutes, then I was going to do that, have a piece be published by noon the same day. And I was building up my portfolio. I was following a lot of my favorite writers and editors who were already in New York, seemed like they were thriving. And some of them were following me too. I created a website for myself on Squarespace where I was paying $15 a month. And I put right in on the front part of the website, I'm looking for Asian representation. And one day I was working at an indie unpaid magazine, online magazine with a couple of college friends. And I put out a call for pitches, and an editor from BuzzFeed retweeted it. And somehow an agent emailed me and said, I saw that you were looking for representation. Do you have any book ideas? And I thought it was a joke, but it wasn't. One of the things that I've been blessed and fortunate about in my career is how things come full circle. So when an agent usually takes interest in you, that you meet up with them pre-pandemic, obviously. And my agent wanted me to meet up with her. She was living in upstate New Jersey. When I went to go meet with her, I had a copy of Bad Feminists by Roxane Gay in my purse. At the time, you know, I will say when Bad Feminist came out, it changed the game for many young women, Black female essayists, because it showed big five publishing houses like HarperCollins, like Macmillan, like Simon & Schuster, that essays can sell, and they can sell incredibly well. And so I met with my agent, we hit it off, and we were trying to figure out, what should I do first? Should I do fiction or nonfiction? Because when I was writing, when I was in high school, when I was being bullied, I was doing fictional stories. But because my online presence was nonfiction, we decided to do nonfiction because I was writing so much about Black women. She thought that I should write an essay collection about Black women. And so I created a book proposal, which is what you have to do, a nonfiction book proposal. And I remember that it was literally the week that I was graduating from my master's program. I apologize, I forgot to say, I went into a master's program at Bennington. It was a low residency program. And low residency means you're not on campus 100% of the time. So I was only on campus twice a year. And then in between, I was doing correspondences with a advisor. So it was actually the week that I was graduating from my MFA program that I was taking calls from editors who were interested in my book, This Will Be My Undoing. And the reason why I wanted to talk about Full Circle Moments is because the imprint that published This Will Be My Undoing is the same imprint that published Bad Feminist. And it was actually Roxane Gay who provided a blurb for This Will Be My Undoing. I had never met her before. We had only talked with each other a handful of times over the internet. And, you know, we emailed a couple of times, but I just want to encourage, you know, a lot of you who are wondering how things come together. I can say as a testament that it's still something that makes me emotional to this day, how things always come full circle. And so when This Will Be My Undoing came out, it was a roller coaster. It was something that I never expected would happen to me. I was considered a lead title, which meant that they were going to promote the heck out of it. And I was getting on all these anticipated lists, and I was scared. You know, I was 25 at the time. I'm 28 now. And I was just like, what's going on? I don't know what's going on. And I remember that, you know, I was traveling around the country. I had this full, like nationwide tour, and it was incredible. And I remember a week into my tour, I'm in my hotel doing interviews for my next book, Wandering in Strange Lands. I was actually working on my second book while I should be enjoying my book tour. And I get a call from my publisher that tells me that I debuted on the New York Times bestseller list. I debuted at number 7. And I remember I actually had a book event that night. And on the way to the book event, I was crying, because I was just so moved by how it resonated with so many people. And since then, a lot of opportunities have opened up for me. I started teaching at Columbia University. I've done speaking engagements and I've spoken at literary festivals. I've been able to do opportunities like this. And I am actually crossing the finish line on my third book, which is a novel that I had been working on since I was in my master's program. And so that has been my life for now during the pandemic. It's just encouraging other writers. I also have a day job where I work at Zora Magazine, which is a digital magazine for women of color. So during the day, I am editing stories from women of color and non-binary people of color, which I love because I never just wanted to be a freelancer. It could be incredibly lonely. And so, yeah, that is pretty much what I do. I teach, I write, I edit, and I also speak. And so I don't look at this type of life as being, well, this is what a writer has to do to make ends meet. I've been very fortunate. I will say that part of the reason why, a huge reason why I've been able to do what I've been able to do is socioeconomic privilege. I graduated from college with no student loans. That gave me the bandwidth to be able to take time to build up my portfolio and live at home rent-free before I came to New York. And so I always try to tell people that. But my one of my biggest goals in my career, aside from writing books, storytelling, is to make sure that people like yourselves don't have it as hard as I do. That when you go to apply for editorial assistant jobs, you shake hands with people that look like you, that you won't have to do unpaid internships. And so I'm really honored to be here with all of you. And thank you for allowing me to talk about my trajectory. So I wanted to read the prologue from my next book. And this is a really a special night for me because I have never read from my book in front of anyone, this next book. And so I just want to give a little bit of an intro. The book is called Wandering in Strange Lands. And basically I wanted to trace family history. It's memoir, it's a personal narrative, it's full of research and historical detail. And all in all, it's an adventure. So I'm gonna read the prologue for you all, and I hope you enjoy it. Prologue, The Milkman's Baby. I was 7 years old when I learned that I wasn't my father's only daughter. He pulled me to his side and said he had something to show me. I assumed that it was a gift. He would regularly visit me at my mother's home, bringing niceties along with his charisma and swagger. Instead, he pulled out his wallet and showed me photos of three girls before saying, "These are your sisters." The oldest was 11 years my senior, the middle child was 8 years my senior, and the last was just 15 months my senior. I don't remember saying anything in response. I didn't have the words to express what I felt. Later, I learned that my father not only had three other daughters, but a wife and a dog as well. They were, from all appearances, the picture-perfect family. I felt like an outsider among my blood, a feeling that would stay with me until I was an adult. My original birth certificate indicates that my story is half missing. I was born Morgan Simone Regis Jerkins. The Simone and Regis were officially my middle names. My mother's name is Sybil Yvonne Jerkins, but there was a blank spot where my father's name should have been. My parents weren't married. In fact, when I was conceived, their relationship had already run its course. On paper, half of my lineage is unknown, although I've known my father my entire life. When I came to this world almost a month early, my dad took one look at me and jokingly said, "That's the milkman's baby," because I was so light. I was the lightest person in my church congregation, and people would often make jokes about my skin to my mother. They'd assume that my father was white because I burned in the sun, or they'd say whatever melanin I had would be lost in the winter. I took all the jokes in stride because I knew that I was loved nevertheless. But on the inside, I was in immense pain because I knew that in many ways, my maternal and paternal families were different with regards to their own histories. My father was born and raised in Fayetteville, North Carolina, and migrated to the North to start his own medical business. Almost 40 years and 30 offices later, he's one of the most prominent doctors in South Jersey. The resemblance between my father and me allows for locals to be able to connect the dots. There were moments in a Macy's or at a doctor's office when someone would regard my face and know that I was my father's daughter. The connection would momentarily reaffirm my existence. But that feeling wouldn't last very long. I was more commonly known as Morgan Jerkins in schools and among friends. It was easier to be known this way because I was already living primarily with my mother. Throughout most of my childhood, I felt more like a Jerkins because my dad and his family were an enigma to me. For one thing, my father's name, John, is spelled like a Frenchman's. His surname, Regis, is French as well. Unlike all the Baptists and Pentecostals I grew up with, he was raised Catholic. And most significant, he carried with him a kind of Southern respectability that, from my point of view, was very distinctive. My father was a first-generation migrant, while my mother was second-generation, and this difference was crucial. He was rooted and she was flighty, never staying in one place for too long. Forgetfulness, even of her family's past, was not necessarily a bad thing for my mother. But for my dad, the past was everything. My father frequently travels to a home in North Carolina that's been in his family for over 60 years. When he speaks of Fayetteville, he tips his nose to the sky and grins. Although my father has been in the North since the early 80s, he knows there is nothing like that soil down there. And that attachment to the land is something Black Northerners, including my mother, just do not have. Only recently have I learned where my maternal grandparents were born. They once lived in Atlantic City and eventually moved to a quieter and wider suburb in Atlantic County to give my mother and her three siblings a better life. But no home has been in our family name for longer than 23 years. My mother moved more than 10 times in the earlier part of her life. These vicissitudes might signal an erratic nature to an outside observer, but my family was simply conditioned to believe that movement meant advancement. Every home had to be better than the last. Being too grounded might lead to stagnation. We weren't rooted like my father's family. The Regis's oral histories were abundant, whereas those of the Jerkinses were vaguer and incomplete. Much of my conversation with my mother's side of the family is characterized by whispers and silences. My maternal grandfather would place a fake mouse outside the door of his children's bedroom whenever grown folks were about to talk, so that my mother and aunt would not eavesdrop. My mother was never that severe in her approach, but I knew that I might be scolded if I stepped outside of my bedroom when adults were conversing. This was one way in which knowledge of who I am and where I came from was kept from me. Even when I was given the space to speak with an adult like my mother, the conversations were full of dead ends. As a child, if I ever inquired about why we sang a particular song at a family dinner, or why we held certain superstitions, I was never satisfied with the answer. That's just what we do, or that's just what Black people do, was never good enough for me. As an adult, I realized that my family simply didn't know how to draw connections with how they think, act, and navigate their lives in a way that forges a community of relatives. They might have been satisfied in the unknown, but I wasn't. No one spoke about the past. The goal was to move forward and never look back. Neither my mother nor I has taken a trip to the South to visit family. We don't talk about the soil like my father and his people. We can talk about the make and model of cars with more accuracy than about the flora and fauna of our homeland. While my father prides himself on origins, my mother prides herself on originality. She believes that you can create your own identity as long as you keep moving. My body, like my lineage, was a mystery because I didn't have a full narrative from either of my two families. I was not confident in my identity and culture. A sense of loss defined both components. My half-baked statements about my heritage stem from a particularly insular northern upbringing. Yet my story is not uncommon. From 1910 to 1970, 6 million African Americans made a grand exodus from the South to the Northwest, to the Northeast, Midwest, and West Coast in search of a better life. This exodus is most commonly known as the Great Migration. Some had families waiting for them at the other end, while others just took a chance to start anew in a place where no one knew their names. Many families allowed their memories to evaporate along with the steam on the locomotives on which they arrived. Many didn't want to talk about their traumatic experiences in the South. Folks like me are the result of these omissions. I've spoken to people whose families are generations deep in the North to investigate this pestering suspicion that we are still intuitively linked to the South. Often at the start of these conversations, I'd hear an apology. The people I spoke with didn't know where their families migrated from. And if they did, they never visited, or they knew where their families migrated from, but they didn't know why their ancestors left or if any family remained on ancestral land. their grandparents and great grandparents didn't talk about the past, so they didn't know how much help they would be to my project. I assured them that I knew what it was like to carry blank spaces and missing pieces. We held no confidence in our origins, African Americans. We resided at terminal points in history, unable to look back. According to historian and University of North Carolina Chapel professor W. Fitzhugh Brundage, much about the transmission of African American memory, for example, remains terra incognita. Historians have been silent about how deep structural changes in African American communities since the mid-20th century have affected the dissemination of African American memory. Much of the information lost during major internal migrations of African Americans has yet to be accounted for. Documentation takes precedence over oral history, a Eurocentric outlook that prioritizes the written word over our own voices. If we were to take my own life as an example, documentation initially proved that half of my parentage was lost, even though I knew who my father was. I carried Regis as a middle name, even while my father's name was absent from my birth certificate. What of the countless families whose lives have been documented, yet whose realities offer an opposing narrative? Because ruptures in cultural memory characterized much of my life and the lives of others in my community, I decided to consider these gaps an opportunity rather than an impasse. I was weary with my conception of self, of diaspora, as one of loss. I was frustrated by how much had been lost from our arrival to the colonies during the transatlantic slave trade to the post-emancipation period when we scattered across the country in massive waves. But the glimmering moment emerged when I wondered, if both of my families have been in this country for several generations, then could it be that a significant recovery of my family's history could be made right here on this American landscape? The only way to find out was to make a journey in reverse and create symbolic bridges between those families who fled and those who remained on the lands of their people. For this book, I traveled to Georgia Lowcountry, to South Carolina, and to Louisiana to speak to some of the oldest microethnic groups of African Americans before traveling west of the Mississippi to further detail the effects of migration on memory and Black identity in Oklahoma and California. I followed the migratory routes of yesteryear and discovered surprising similarities among African Americans of these particular regions regarding what they feel is at stake in their communities and who they are as a people. I've included the scraps, rubble, and frayed threads of my personal history alongside those of descendants of migrants to illuminate how cultural conditioning via religion and spirituality, connection with nature, or understanding of Black identity has been altered through both systemic and personal forces. The undertaking has a dual purpose: to excavate the connective tissue that complicates but unites us as a people, and to piece together the story of how I came to be by going back and looking beyond myself, a liberating and healing pilgrimage. Despite all the differences I encountered, I ultimately came away from my journey feeling that all is not lost. Much of our cultural history that has not been retained can be found in people you have yet to encounter and places where you have not yet traveled. I know, because I've met them, and they've been waiting to meet you too. So that is the prologue of my book, Wandering Strange Lands, that comes out August 4th. And if you are interested, you can pre-order right now. I think it's fantastic, if I do say so myself, and it really stretched me in terms of a writer and researcher. So enough about me. We are going to go into the first prompt, and I thought that this prologue would be an incredible segue into the first prompt because I am so interested in memory and how it influences our writing, how it influences the way in which we navigate the world, how we survive, how we protect ourselves, and also how we hide. And so we're going to keep on that theme of parents and guardians, those who help to mold and condition us for better or for worse. And so I want us to take 7 minutes, and I want you to think about a moment in your lives where you realized, whether through your actions or through maybe through your beliefs, that you're different from your parents or your guardian. And so let's do that right now.
Where it is that you come from, yeah.
Okay, so prompt number two. I love this one. Think of your favorite color. Write a story based on a memory attached to that color that illuminates something about your personality and or how you navigate the world. So we'll take another, how long we do this for? 7 minutes for this one as well.
So 6:51.
Yep.
51. Math.
I'm sorry, I don't shave my legs at night. I'm sorry, I'm not your baby mama. I'm sorry, you got karma coming to you. Collect your soul, get it right. To me like you say you do, 'cause it's hard enough you got to treat me like this, lonely enough to let you treat me like this. Do you really love me or just wanna love me down? Thinking late thoughts, replace my blue. I do not struggle in your web, because it was my aim to get caught. But daddy long legs, I feel that I'm finally growing weary of waiting to be consumed by you. Give me the first taste, let it begin. Heaven cannot wait forever, darling, just start the chase. I'll let you win, but you must make the
So, last but not least, we're going to go on to the third prompt. This one might be a little bit more difficult. So, you know, you might not have needed the full 7 minutes. Maybe you were jamming out. Now you might need it. The last prompt is, tell me a story about a person who you misjudged based on your own beliefs and opinions at the time and how you reconsider that person as you've gotten older. So we'll take the full 7 minutes again for this one. Okay, so the Q&A, somebody asked, how did I come up with such inspiring prompts? Well, I'll say that I used one of them, I think one or two of them before, in other places. But I love using the parent model. We learn so much from our parents, whether we like it or not. And so they know us so well, and they also don't know us so well. So I've always been interested in trying to figure out the spaces where the lines are blurred with that familial relations. With color, I'm always interested in why are you drawn to a particular color? What does it bring out of you and why? As far as the third one, I love it because great essayists are those who have self-awareness. So when I ask that prompt about, well, what about when you misjudge someone? It is supposed to, it's like an exercise, it's like calisthenics, basically to help to see, you know, how self-aware can you be? How vulnerable and uncomfortable you can be? You can say, you know what, I was wrong. The best essays are those that are full of self-awareness, not those that are narcissistic and narrow. Another question, yep.
There are quite a few about your writing schedule and your writing regimen, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So writing schedule, it all depends. If I'm working on, like, for the novel that I'm working on, it was a thing about 2 weeks ago where I was getting up very early and I was starting at 6:30 in the morning. And because so much is happening in our society right now, and because I work in a digital magazine, and I have to be so tethered to media, I downloaded an app called Self Control, where you can write websites that you don't that you want to be blocked for a certain amount of time, so you can't go to them. And once you put that allotted time, you can't reverse it. But I'm not a person that writes all day. I will write at most 4 or 5 hours a day, but I break it up. So maybe 2.5 hours in the morning, 2.5 hours at night, 4 hours in the morning, 1 hour after I get a nap. I don't go straight through. It's always important to find your stride. If you know that your mind is the sharpest in the evening, write in the evening. If you know, I know my mind is the sharpest in the morning, the early morning. I'm not sharp in the mid-afternoon, so I don't write then. But it all depends on where I am. If I'm not working on a big project, I usually just try to write in the mornings. That's the best time for me. Another question I had was, what was the big dream I had when I was younger? I thought I wanted to follow my father's footsteps and run a medical business. I thought I was going to try to get an MD, PhD from Columbia and become like a cardiologist or something. And I did not always want to be a writer. I wanted to become a writer from the age of 14 on. Morel asks, how do you stay motivated to write during quarantine? Reading, brainstorming with friends, and also that self-control app. Because of, you know, the protests were going on or still are going on and everything with this terrible administration, it's very hard to keep centered on one thing, right? So sometimes I have to put certain things in place so that I can concentrate. Kelly asks, any tips for overcoming imposter syndrome? Here's what I'll say. I still struggle with imposter syndrome, especially as a Black woman. There are many times where I feel like I don't deserve what I have, or I'll read my name on the cover of my book or in a byline, and I have to remind myself, like, that's my name. And I think what's so good for overcoming imposter syndrome is to have your people. And what I mean by that is those people in your life that who uplift you and know you, who believe that you are full and you are everything, even when you're not writing. And when it comes to fear of writing, that doesn't go away. I always tell people that the best thing you can do is to acknowledge your fear and to do it anyway. Oftentimes the stuff that you're most afraid of writing is the stuff that deserves to be immortalized. So the goal should never be to get rid of it. The goal is to just acknowledge it and to just keep working through it. Another question that I had, Junko asked for my book, how did I choose the place of memory that I wanted to go to? I would say you have to read the book to figure that out. But part of the place I knew where I had to go to, I knew I had to go to each region of the United States because African Americans migrated to each region of the United States. But I also knew because of certain regions of the country, that I knew that my family was from. Like, I know my father is Creole, so I knew I had to go to Louisiana. I knew that there were these oral histories about my family being both Black and Indigenous, and I knew that there was, you know, I wanted to go to what was known as Indian Territory, which is Oklahoma, where Indigenous people were forced to migrate across the Mississippi to that area from the Trail of Tears. So I went there, for example. So that's how I chose some of the places. How did I approach the research for my new book? Oh man, academic journals, looking up documentaries, finding the names of the people speaking in these documentaries about African-American life, and then finding if they have an email address or a Twitter or a Facebook and reaching out to them before I decided to travel, getting in touch with scholars, hiring an outside transcriptionist to help me with the interviews. And someone asked, what were some of the most memorable people you spoke with? I, for my book, I spoke with the woman who was one of the first responders to the 1965 riots, in other words, known as the Watts riots, one of the biggest riots in American history. That was one of the most memorable people that I spoke to. She invited me to her home and everything, and that was in California. Talia asks, "What are your two tips for killing a memoir essay? Having your anecdote. We should be immediately brought into a scene." Right? We should know, what are you trying to assert and how are you going to get there? The what is the idea, the how is the anchor, the vehicle, the story itself. Okay? So I can tell you I want to write about racism, but what is the actual story? What is the anchor point there? So those are the biggest tips that I would have, is just to know what you're trying to write about, but also have that story, that visceral anecdote, what makes even these well-trodden themes original. How did I find my time in Bennington as a person of color? I liked it. I was not in Vermont 24/7, so I can't speak to the culture year round, but I was there January and June for 10 days doing residencies, and I loved my time there. If any of you are considering getting an MFA and you want to do low residency, I would strongly encourage you to apply. It was at Bennington where I actually learned craft. How did you find freelance writing positions? So what I did, I was on Twitter and I saw that a lot of editors had their email addresses right in their bios, and I just pitched them. I had no idea how to construct the pitch. I got rejected, but it was from those rejections that I learned how to pitch. Tips on applying for editor jobs. Read the site thoroughly. Think about what the job is going to entail. I would suggest, like, you know, try to get some type of editing experience under your belt, whether it's freelancing, whatever. Those are the tips that I would have. And also talk to people who do these types of jobs. It's okay to reach out and ask. Eunice asks, do you use prompts as an exercise to writing? No, not all the time. Like, I tend to think of things in my head, but oftentimes things come to me when I'm reading. I make up prompts when I like discussing with individuals like yourself, because they even give me more ideas. I think prompts are just such a collaborative effort. For me, I like to do them with people more than by myself. What are some of the favorite books I've read over the past year? I loved The Old Drift, and I'll type that in there. The Old Drift. By Namwali Serpelli, The Collected Schizophrenias, by Esme Weizhong Wang. I loved, I don't know the whole title, but Beautiful Experiments by Sadia Hartman. And what other books? The Dream House by Carmen Maria Machado. I loved Pachinko by Min Jin Lee. What is your editing process like? I need a professional editor, because a lot of times when I'm writing personal material, I'm so knee deep in it that I can't see where I'm missing things. I usually work with a professional editor. Like, when it comes to my books, we go over the drafts multiple times. And I like to think of editing as in working in layers. So the first iteration, I might work on character development. The second iteration, it might be dialogue. The third might be the scenes. I think of it like, I always tell my students, I think of it like painting. When you're painting, you don't just do one layer. In order to make it full and vibrant and color, you gotta go over it a couple of times. And so that's what I like to do with my editing, just go over it multiple times to really bring out the vitality of the story. And so my book tour, Sue, is definitely gonna be all virtual. I'm gonna be promoting it on my Instagram, promoting on Twitter, and also on my professional page. So be on the lookout. We're bringing together all the conversation partners now, and it's really exciting. What's your best tip for making an essay collection marketable? Don't worry about marketability. read books that are current. Yes. Read essay collections that have sold. Pay attention to Publishers Weekly and Publishers Marketplace for essay collections that are sold so you know what's on the market. But if you have a strong thesis, a strong argument, it's going to make for one hell of a proposal. Any other questions? These were really good. Kaylin asks, what brought your attention to take a direction towards a writing career? When I was at home, in my bedroom, my childhood bedroom, I saw people exchanging content online. And I was like, whoa, people my age can publish things and get paid for it. So I was like, okay, I can actually transition into not just writing in the nooks and crannies of my room. I can actually turn this into a professional venture. Someone asks, what's the proper structure of a pitch to an editor? Make sure your subject header is pitched with some type of colon and then has some type of title, a working title for the piece. In the body of the email, two questions that you have to ask. It's a two-part question. What am I trying to assert and how am I going to assert it? Like I said with the essay, the what is the idea, the how is the argument, the vehicle, the story. So for example, if I wanted to tell you, I want to write about African-Americans migrating across the South. Okay, that's the idea. What's the story? I want to write about how I am the descendant of migrants from the South who did not tell me about the fullness of my Black identity. So therefore, I'm going to take the trip in reverse to discover that. That is the vehicle, right? So you just have to take it a step further. So that's the proper structure of a pitch to an editor. A lot of times writers get pitches rejected because they only give the idea. They don't give us a story, an anchor to which we can hold on to. So make sure you have both the idea and the anchor.
We did get a question about what your next project is.
Okay. My next project is a novel, and I'll give you a little tidbit. In African-American folklore, there's a belief that if you have a call, which is
when I want to listen. Huh?
Sorry, I'm muted.
There's a belief in African-American folklore that if you have a call, which is means that if you were born in the amniotic sac as a child, that you have healing properties. And so my next project, which is a novel, is writing about a matriarchal family of call-bearing women and how they create this capitalistic enterprise by selling parts of themselves in order to survive, and how that intersects with motherhood and personal ambition in a rapidly gentrifying neighborhood that is Harlem. So that is my third project. It's a novel that's called Call Baby. So fans of Ta-Nehisi Coates, The Water Dancer, Edward P. Jones, All on Hagar's Children, Jacqueline Woodson's novels, or Toni Morrison's Beloved, perhaps. You might like it.
Everyone, feel free to unmute yourselves, please. I would love to have a huge round of applause for Morgan. Oh my gosh, this is wonderful.
Thank you.
Amazing. Thank you.